Heavenly Father, we praise you, Father, for the Sabbath. As we draw nearer and nearer to the end of this earth's history, and we don't even realize how close we truly are, the Sabbath's become far more important, Father, as a time of peace, as a time of being able to come together with like believers, as a time of having concern for others, as a time of begging for your Holy Spirit to come upon us that we may be more powerful for you and get sin out of our lives, Father. Please be with us this Sabbath day. Be with Pastor Bill, Lord, and may your Holy Spirit, may your angels be here in this place. We invite them and beg their presence. And may our worship and activities be acceptable to you on this Sabbath day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We were talking about the temple and the high priest of the temple last week, and we spoke about the building of the temple as it was or is in 1 Kings 6. Then we had moved on to Hebrews 8 through 1. I just want to read out of 1 Kings 6 one of Mrs. White's statements, which I think are extremely important for us never to forget, because the one thing the devil does best is drive a stake between God's people and divide. But we cannot lose sight of the fact that that's not God's plan at all. And, you know, at Pentecost, when Peter spoke, and the apostles and the elders and the deacons and the workers of that day came out of the upper room filled with the Holy Spirit, Jerusalem was only filled with Jews, right? Only Hebrews there, right? Only people that understood Peter's tongue, right? No, there were people from all over the world. Many different nationalities, many different languages. And what happened when Peter spoke? They all under, and who was the mediator there? Man? Were there interpreters standing there? Jesus clearly put forth the principle that there is no division in his word due to language. He clearly stated right there. And I want to read this statement Mrs. White said. And through this study, we clearly see that we are the stones that make up the temple. We are the raw material that's to be shaped and formed into a rock that perfectly fits. Into a stone that perfectly fits. And who holds it all together? I want you to take that word cornerstone and scribble it out of your Bible. Do you know why? Because I want you to put main support pillar in there, because that's what a cornerstone is. That's what a cornerstone is. We established last week, not us, but the scripture in Ephesians, that the foundation that this temple was built on is what? What did Paul say? You remember? The prophets and the apostles. However, he says apostles and prophets. Now, what does that infer? What does that mean? All the New Testament. This is the foundation. And Christ being the chief cornerstone, we'll take a pencil and write next to that the main support structure. The main support pillar. That's what the cornerstone is. However, the bedrock upon which it's built is him too, because what does it say about you? In the beginning was the Word, and the Word became flesh. So who is the Old and the New Testament? Jesus Christ. So Mrs. White says here, and then because I want to move on into Hebrews, and I want to read underneath, those of you who have the Ellen White Study Bibles, chapter 6, or as I liked it, the Seventh-day Adventist Bible. I like that. I like that God gave us our own Bible, our own light. Not that we shy away from it as being called that. That's what that is. That's the Word of God, complete with His prophets, which she is one of. Praise God. I will not shy away from that. Yes, this is absolutely a Seventh-day Adventist Bible. And there is information in this Bible that's the only place you can get it. is here. The meaning of the midnight cry, the meaning of behold, comes the bridegroom, be prepared to go out and meet him. You better be ready for the judgment. We're the only ones that have the answer to that. And it's here in this Seventh-day Adventist study Bible. Yes, I'm proud of my Seventh-day Adventist Bible. Are you? Are you proud of your prophet? Honored? The Seventh-day, we can't have those Bibles anymore because they'll say it's a Seventh-day Adventist Bible. Yes, it is. Yes, it absolutely is. Just as the Jews had their Bible. The Torah. Anyhow. She says here, underneath chapter 6, verse 7 of 1 Kings, it would be the second paragraph down. There's a long paragraph, then a little short one. It says, let no one think there need not be a stroke placed upon them. There is no person, no nation that is perfect in every habit and thought. One must learn of another. Therefore, God wants the different nationalities to mingle together. What do we strive to do today? Separate. For what reason? Culture. I don't read that there. I don't read that there. Do you read that there? Does it say, well, you know, you got to have your own culture? No. It says, because we're not perfect, we must mingle together to be one in judgment and in purpose. To be one in judgment, and in other words, there's only one Holy Spirit. He is not going to put on a different costume for each congregation, or a different music, or a different style of worship. Then the union that there is in Christ will be, what does that say? Exemplified. There must be unity. No matter where we come from, if we claim to Christ is our older brother, what differences can we have? Especially in culture. It will be his culture, won't it? Jesus, in his own culture, refused to partake of some of the things. Why? Why? Do you remember what Mrs. White says? Some were tradition, and some of them were not the proper spirit in which he wanted to be seen. Remember the wedding feast? He did not go with his brothers. Why? It was his culture. Because he didn't want to be seen in the same spirit that they were in. You see? So we need to be careful about all that. But this, the powers to be have pushed this issue of culture, haven't they? Oh, we all have to, but it's divisions, it's separation. Remember the old divide and conquer? If God is our Father and Jesus is our older brother, how many cultures are there? And whose might that be? The culture of heaven. We all have differences. Oh, yes. We all have different backgrounds. However, we must all come together in Christ. And that's the power of the Holy Spirit. That's the power of the temple to bring, to be all inclusive, not exclusive. I want to read you out of Strong's, and I'm doing it this way because it's easier for me. Not that I can see these words because they're so tiny. But I brought something to combat that, Donna. Now I can't see you, but I can see this. Okay, and the reference I want to read to you, and I find it quite interesting, and I brought this up, but I didn't have a chance to read it, is the Hebrew for the word temple. The word that appears here is reference number 1964, of course, in the Hebrew. And it simply says temple. And the root of it is what's important. It comes from 3201, which I'm going to read here in a minute. However, it simply says, a large public building, such as a palace or temple. Palace, temple, no big deal, right? However, you'll notice it says large public building. What does that mean? Everybody's welcome. But it also means palace. Royalty can dwell in a temple, correct? Now, let's look at the root word, which would be 3201. This is very interesting. It says here, to be able, many, might, to be able, any at all, always, attain, can, could, endure, might, overcome, have power, prevail, still, suffer. Do you understand what that's saying? To be able to overcome. To be able to have might. To be able to suffer. How did Jesus suffer what he did? Because his Father was in his temple. That's pretty amazing. To prevail. That's what the word temple means in the Hebrew. But you know something, folks? Is Jesus always going to be there? What's going to happen? And when he walks out, what happens? He's no longer the high priest, is he? He becomes Michael. Oh, his salvation is forever. But he becomes Michael. What does that mean? What will he return as? Is he going to come as a downtrodden, despised? He will be riding as a conquering king, coming back to take what is his by right. You know, this idea that you're dissing me, you owe me respect. No, I don't owe you one bit of respect. I can be courteous and kind to you, but you have to earn my respect. Isn't that correct? Do we have to earn our children's respect through our actions? Did God earn our respect through what he did at Calvary? Did he just say, you have to worship me because I'm God? You're dissing me. I'm going to kill you. Is that what he said? Or did he say, watch what I'm going to do for you? Now, will you come to me? Will you come into my temple? Will you become part of my temple? Will you be a palace? Will you dwell as royalty with me? Did he earn our respect? So what should our example be to people? Should we immediately demand respect from people? Don't we need to prove ourselves first? So where's this attitude come from? It's certainly not from the scriptures. And you know, a lot of people are laying in their graves because of that attitude. He disrespected me, so I killed him. How many times have you heard that? Well, do I owe you respect? I don't know. Simply by that attitude, I can tell you I don't. I'll be courteous and kind. However, for me to respect you, you have to show that you're worthy of it. Can you act like a slob and a bum and a bully and then demand respect? That's a thug. Jesus Christ came and earned our respect. Did he have to do that? See, that's what I don't understand. He already had everybody's attention one way or another. Because the scripture says even the devil and demons believe and shudder at the name of Christ. So he's got their respect. But he came here, and all through eternity, he will carry those marks. And Mrs. White tells us that the Father and the Son and even the Holy Spirit all through eternity will carry a sorrow in their heart for even the devil, all those that were lost. I don't know why he cares. But anyhow, we went over to Hebrews 8. Now, we looked at what a temple means in Hebrew. We looked at the fact that our prophet tells us when we're talking about the building of the temple, because that's what 1 Kings 6 is about, correct? That it is for everybody. All nationalities, all races, all cultures are to melt into one. We saw that at the foot of Mount Sinai, didn't we? What happened there? Was there a little cultural issue there? When Moses went up on the mountain, what did they do? They started dancing and carrying on and melting down their jewelry and making golden calves. And God did not like that culture, did he? Many people died at the foot of Mount Sinai because of that. They all had to become of Christ. Well, Chuck, respect, I don't want to get off on that, but respect is something earned through, in my estimation, through humility. You're not going to earn my daughter's respect by lording over her. I have to show her that I love her. I have to show her that I'm willing to tolerate her. But yet, she has to be corrected. And also respect for authority. You know, Chuck, when you were in the service, you had officers, right? Some of them you respected, and I guarantee you, some of them you did not. And I know in my case, some I called sir, and some I called by their rank. Do you know what I'm talking about? Because you're not supposed to call an officer by their rank, are you, really, technically? They're all sirs. But the ones that were out for themselves, lieutenant, captain, major, I would call them that. Never called them sir. I only saluted them because the Army said I had to. However, the ones that were that got down with us, the ones that were truly concerned about the troops, the ones that wanted to see harmony, and not just worried about their next promotion, were called sir. And I'd do anything for those officers. You know what I'm talking about, right, David? Even some of the higher-ranking NCOs. I would do anything for those officers. And I even told some officers, I said, you know what? I can make or break you, because I'm the platoon sergeant. Those guys will listen to me before they will you. And I can get you kicked out of this platoon. Oh, they used to get mad. You know what I'm talking about. So either you treat the men properly, like the respect they're due, because they went through the two, or we're going to make your life very difficult. You know what I'm talking about. You have to show people that you're willing to accept them, I think. Then you work out your differences. Is that correct? I don't know. Jesus came and accepted us all, even the worst of the worst, and said, I am accepting and loving you all. Accept me, and then we can work it out. But he didn't come as a bully. He didn't, oh, look at who I am, you know? I'm the creator. You have to worship me. There would have been major rebellion. The devil would have been right, wouldn't he? He wouldn't be the devil. We'd all side with him, wouldn't we? Say, he's right. That guy's a tyrant. But no, that's not what he did. The devil's the tyrant. He presses us into the sin. He cheats. He steals. He lies. He doesn't tell us the truth. I think that's one of the most important things to gain somebody, is always be honest with them. Whether it hurts you or not, whether you're going to have to take a bullet, if you will, for your honesty or not. But one of the biggest ways, I think, to lose somebody's respect is lie to them. I think. My opinion. And as a child, can you pretty much figure out when parents are lying to you? Oh, you can see through it. You can see through it so quickly. When they're appeasing you, telling you this, that, and one day you wake up and you realize, well, how many times did they tell me they were going to, and they never did it. And you stop respecting your parents. Did Jesus ever lie to us? Can you find one place where there's a contradiction? See, that's the difference in my mind. Hypocrisy is another issue. Is Jesus a hypocrite? Is the devil a hypocrite? Oh, yeah. Are most churches hypocritical? I love the old statement, do as I do, not as I say. You've lost their respect right there. Right there, you've lost their... Because hypocrisy and lying are the same thing, aren't they? It's deceptive, isn't it? One of the biggest things I want my daughter to understand is I'm not perfect. Far from it. I make mistakes. But we need to work them out. I do things wrong in dealing with her. She needs to understand that. Not try and cover them up. However, that doesn't change the consequences of a situation either, does it? There are times out of anger when you say things that I shouldn't. That needs to be rectified. And not just rectified, but it has to be a learning situation for me. Because, you know, she picks those character traits up, doesn't she? Like a little magnet. Like it or not. And I think, Chuck, that, and we've been studying about priests and temples, a priest in a temple that does not tell the truth is of absolutely no value. A priest in a temple that smooths over the hurt of my people is an abomination. How can you have respect for an organization or a person that knows the truth but wants to run away from it and deny it, especially in the times we're in? Think about it. Or wants to meld together with all the other apostasy. How can God, can that be a holy temple anymore? Or a synagogue of Satan, as it says in Revelation. Those who claim to be Jews, but are of the synagogue of Satan. Those who claim to be Seventh-day Adventists, those who claim to be Christians, but subscribe to the stones of the Romans, of the pagan, of the heathen. And many of them know deep down inside it's not what they're supposed to be doing. And the others don't care. Can you gain the respect? Even an enemy will have great respect for a foe who stands their ground no matter what. They will show them great respect. They'll probably kill them when they capture them, but they will show them respect. It'll go far worse for a person who is not standing for their principles. Over here in Hebrews 8, I want to read some of these verses, and then I want to look at a few things here, because there's a great contrast between this ministry and the ministry we see back in the first century church, and even today. We read some of these verses last week, but we're gonna go from Hebrews 8, verse 1. Now, of the things which we have spoken, this is the sum. Now, in chapter 7, Paul establishes the fact that Jesus Christ is the high priest. He's Melchizedek. Paul establishes the fact that Melchizedek was even back there with Abraham, who was the Holy Spirit. Paul establishes the fact that it is no longer by birthright that you are a priest. It is by, thus saith the Lord. He says that. Anyhow, now of the things which we have spoken, this is the sum. We have such a high priest who is set on the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens, a minister of the sanctuary and of the true tabernacle, which the Lord pitched, and not man. This is not by man's rules at all. There is no human interference or subversity or cleverness or false theology in this temple. Why? Simply because man can't get his hands on it. God saw to it. For every high priest is ordained to offer gifts and sacrifices, whereof it is of necessity that this man have somewhat to offer also. Now this man that is being referred to here is Jesus. This man, the high priest. What did he offer? What was his sacrifice, by the way? Was there ever any other priest mentioned in the Bible that did that? That offered his own blood for the cleansing of sins? And then ministered with it? No. That's amazing, isn't it? Verse 4. For if he were on earth, he should not be a priest, seeing that these are priests that offer according to the law. Now, who are the priests that offer according to the law? What's he talking about? The Levitic, by birthright, by ordination, by right. Jesus was not a priest according to that. Why? He was of the tribe of Judah. He wasn't a Levite. And I had mentioned this last week. John the Baptist made that very clear when he said two things. Behold the Lamb of God, which takes away the sin of the world. Now, and I've said this a bunch of times, but we need to comprehend what John was saying. He also said, I must decrease and he must increase. What tribe was John from? John the Baptist, what tribe? He was a Levite. What did John's father do for a living? High priest. High priest. When John the Baptist said, being a priest by right, behold the Lamb of God, which takes away the sin of the world, did John know where the Jews believed sin was taken away? And that would have been in a temple. By who? The high priest. John said, no, not anymore. Behold the Lamb of God, and he pointed to Jesus, which takes away the sin of the world. That system's done. The law. Then he said, not then, but later on, I must decrease. The Levitical priesthood is done, and the Melchizedek, the heavenly sanctuary, is open for business. That's what he was saying. Personally, yes, same thing. However, it's got much broader ramifications coming from the son of the high priest when you're talking about the priesthoods. This is where your sins get taken away, no longer through man. There is no such thing as man saving man. It doesn't work. That's the system we have today worldwide. That is the system in place. No matter what church you go to, that's what you're going to hear. Man saving man. You don't need to be perfect. Now, when you hear that, that's satanic, Luciferian doctrine. What did the snake, what did the devil say to Eve? You don't have to be perfect. You can sin, and you're not going to die. If a church or a theology tells you that you can sin and still go to heaven, that's just the same words as that Eve was told. Isn't it? And by the way, Adam and Eve were on probation too at that time, weren't they? So when you hear that kind of doctrine, I don't care who it comes from, run. Because you're standing where you shouldn't be. You're on ground you should not be on. And you will be deceived sooner or later. Because we cannot match wits with the devil. It is impossible. And the Lord has, and the Holy Spirit has given us safeguards. And when we start to hear this, it's time to go. Because you are dealing with the devil right there. Make no doubt of it. You're not going to save that person. Just as Eve couldn't do a thing with that snake. Nor could Adam. A silly animal. Trick them. You're not going to do a thing with it. And you're not standing in the temple of God. And if that's the attitude, and if sin is tolerated in that organization, you need to get out of there. Quick. I don't care what it is. You need to go. If it claims to be of Christ. So, John the Baptist clearly laid out, and he was the preceding message of Christ, wasn't he? He was the herald of Christ. Now, we're the herald of Christ now too, aren't we? We're to be preaching that message, the Elijah message, aren't we? So, we need to point people away from organizations, away from earthly priesthoods, to the heavenly. That's the only place there's salvation. Behold the Lamb of God, which takes away my sin and your sin. Doesn't say, behold the Lamb of God, which lets us all live in our sin. Is that what he said? No, takes it away. He was the sacrifice that the sin was put on. Literally, what John the Baptist said was absolutely true. My sins, your sins, the sins of this world were transferred onto the head of that sacrifice, Jesus Christ, and pronounced banished. Now, we're the ones that go out and dig them up. I often think of it as, at the foot of the cross is all the garbage, isn't it? All the garbage. All our trash, all our sins is thrown there. But then Jesus said, fine, I've taken your sin away. Now I'm going to minister for you to keep it away. But we like to go back and dig through that garbage, don't we? Would you ever think of doing that? How many people here want to next tomorrow put on their nice clothes and go down and dig through the local dump? How many people wanted to see if they could find anything good? Then why do we keep digging up our sins? Why don't we leave them in those where they belong? Anyhow, see, this the earthly priesthood cannot do. Verse 5, who serve unto the example and shadow of the heavenly things, as Moses was admonished of God when he was about to make the tabernacle. Now listen to this. Listen to what's said here. For see, saith he, that you make all things according to the pattern shown to you in the mount. What was the command given to Moses when he was making the tabernacle? You can't vary from the blueprint one tiny bit. You must see to it that it is done exactly as I tell you. Now, what was the tabernacle for? What is it for? Well, the temple. Tabernacle is a different word. It is, let him build them build me a tabernacle that I may dwell amongst them. Was it God's idea to have the tabernacle outside the camp? Why was it built outside? Why was it moved outside the camp? Because of what happened with the golden calf. God realized that if they wanted me to dwell with them, they're going to have to make an effort and come out and see me. Because there's too much going on there. They need to be separated out of that influence to worship me. So, the tabernacle was built for a dwelling place, but it was also for God, for deity. But it was also to get rid of what? To deal with sin, right? You brought your sins, and it was transferred onto the tabernacle. The blood was sprinkled on the veil. The blood was applied to the horns of the altars, both the altar in the courtyard, the altar of incense. Different things were done with different bloods, but however they were applied. Now, Moses was told to build the tabernacle, and what did Paul call his body? Yeah, he called it a tabernacle too, didn't he? When I leave this earthly tabernacle, he said. You see? When Moses was built, and this is important, folks, when Moses was told to build it exactly how I tell you, because this is how we deal with sin. I'm the master builder. I'm the one that drew the blueprints. I am the one that takes away your sin. You have no variance from that plan. Now this tabernacle, this temple, has to be built exactly the same way as we're being shown. We can't vary from that blueprint or that pattern one bit. Would deity have dwelt in that tabernacle if Moses said, you know something? I really don't like the color of that door. It just isn't appealing. We're going to change the color of that door. You think? Well, there was a little incident that happened inside that tabernacle. Aaron's sons did something. Do you remember? And they didn't change the color of anything. They simply did something they were told not to do. They lit with, and they died on the spot in front of all of Israel for it. That's how serious God is in building his tabernacle, his palace. If we alter it, can the description that I read out of the concordance, the second word, can it be a place to overcome? Can it be a place of might? Can it be a place to empower? No. It'll be changed. So Moses was told, see to it that you build it up exactly as I have shown you. Now, sometimes when we build structures, things happen out in the field, and we have to get what we call an engineering letter. And an engineering letter is, there's a variance from the blueprint because something was unforeseen or simply because a mistake was made. Now, it doesn't mean that the structure will be any less strong. However, there's a sealed stamp from an engineer on there that says this is the way it has to be built. Now, something will happen with a steel issue or a concrete. And then, to continue on, you have to get what's called an engineering letter. They go back to the engineer. The engineer looks at what the revisions were and says, okay. And he simply writes a letter stating, I approve that. Or, he says, no. With God, there is no letters. We call them a letter, getting a letter. He wrote it once. And that is it. Perfection. Thank you, Eddie. And Dennis was talking about character building in Sabbath school. The pattern that he shown Moses in the mountain was this, right here. This is the tabernacle. This is the temple. This is the sanctuary. This is the plan of salvation. This is our clothing, with the exception of a few items on here. This is it. This is what he showed him. This is what he showed him. You see? Now, what cultural divide can there come here? What cultural divide do you see here? Do you see any cultural divides? We all have to wear this robe. We all have to wear these colors. We all have to wear this helmet. We all have to have that holiness to the Lord. We all have to have the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. We all have to have a soundly built structure that Larry, Louise, and Barbara, and Reginald, and Jackie, they're all stones that fit one on top of the other perfectly, together. Without any hammer, without any chisel, without any mortar. They fit together so tightly that not even sunlight or moisture or rain can drive through them. Sitting on a perfectly level foundation. Being ministered to by God himself through his son Jesus. Being controlled by God's spirit. His character through his spirit. What variation is there? What building do you want to be in? And for one purpose, to glorify God, to experience God, to dwell with God. I want to read some of Mrs. White's commentary. Of course, you can't go through this without that in my mind. and see what the prophet has to say. Our prophet, our precious prophet. Now, I want you to listen to what she says here, because, folks, I've been saying for months that the Jews were Christians, right? Everybody says no? Oh, really? Listen. She says here, right under verses 1 and 2, the Jewish tabernacle was a type of the Christian church. Now, when she says the Jewish tabernacle, was she talking about the last temple that Titus destroyed in AD 70? Or was she talking about the one they built out in the wilderness at the foot of Mount Sinai? She says tabernacle, she doesn't say temple. Was a type of a Christian church. The church on earth, composed of those who are faithful and loyal to God, is the true tabernacle. Faithful to who? The conference? Faithful to an organization? Faithful to a government? Faithful to some independent minister? No. She says the church on earth, composed of those who are faithful and loyal to God, is the true tabernacle. Wherefore, the Redeemer is the minister. God and not man pitched this tabernacle on a high, elevated platform. On a high, elevated platform. Now, if you are not following God, if you are not following Jesus, and if you are not striving for the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, you are not on that platform. I don't care who you claim to be. You have stepped off it. And you know, you'll notice she says a high and elevated platform. Now, this is a platform, but it's not high, is it? I can step off that. It wouldn't matter, would it? Nothing's going to happen to me. Let's jack it up 20 feet. Now, do I want to take a step off it? What's going to happen? My ears are going to be where my feet should be, and my feet are going to be where my ears should be. You may not survive that fall. See the problem? So if you want to step off the platform, the high and elevated holy platform that Jesus himself traverses and controls and operates and runs, you're falling into the abyss. There may not be a bottom. There may not be a bottom. You just may fall forever until it splashes into the lake of fire. Is that a good place to be? And for those who want to claim that the Sabbath and the Old Testament, that was the Jewish Sabbath. That was the Jewish, well, it says here it was a type of Christian church. Want to argue with that? You go right ahead. How high is the platform, by the way, that Mrs. White is talking about here? Can anybody tell me? There's a hint in the script we just read. How high is that platform? Reaches all the way to heaven. Because where's Jesus? Where's he ministering? Where's God? The Lord is in his holy temple. Remember, temple in Hebrew means palace too. That's how high that platform is. It is in heaven. And when we step on Christ's church's platform, where are we? We're in heaven. What did Jesus say? When does salvation start? Here on earth. Here on earth. We need to follow Christ immediately. And we're in heaven. We are on his platform. And we also have a great example of that, because when Jesus came out of the grave, he had a different character than he went in with, right? Was there a transformation there? It was exactly the same character. That's how they recognized him, by his habits, by his speech, by his character, because his appearance had changed. His body had become immortalized. All the imperfections, all the stress, all the distress, All the stripes, with the exception of a few, were gone. All the scars. And he was perfect. They didn't recognize his glorified body. But they recognized his character, didn't they? So when we accept Christ, we are put on that high and holy platform, which is in heaven. And it's as if we never left. We're the ones that choose to fall off it. And we continue and we with Christ. And he continues to sanctify us as we go through our process. His process. Sanctification is not a lifetime job. It's an eternal job. We will constantly be developing character all through eternity. I don't know what that means, folks. But right here, we have to get over the sin problem. That's the issue here, isn't it? In a nutshell? Can we do that ourselves? No. Behold the Lamb of God, which takes away the sin of the world, and then becomes the high priest, which means works it out that we don't sin anymore through those colors. She says, the tabernacle is Christ's body. And from north, south, east, and west, he gathers those who shall help to compose it. A holy tabernacle is built up of those who receive Christ as their personal Savior. Now, how can there be division? How can there be division? Christ is the minister of the true tabernacle, the high priest of all who believe in him as a personal Savior. There it is. We must take directions from him, not from some little book or some group or council. It's already been done. It's already been said, it's already been stated. See to it that you build it after the pattern that I have given you. Here it is. Here's the pattern, right there. Know and understand what that means. And there is the plan of salvation. There is sanctification, righteousness, justification. It's all there. And he who earned our respect is the teacher. Not one who demands it. Because a day is coming when he will demand it. And every knee shall bow and say, yes, he is. But it's going to be too late for the vast majority of those who dwelt on this earth. Even the devil will give way at that time. And his judgments are righteous and just. And folks, don't think that if you're in the city, you're not going to know anybody outside that city. Don't think for one minute that as the New Jerusalem comes down and the hordes come up to try and take it, as the devil marshals his armies, as God's people go to the walls and look down, you're not going to see people you don't know out there. It's going to happen. Don't you think? And they're going to cry, God, God, why have you forsaken? Why have you left me out here to die? And what's God's answer going to be? I did not leave you out there to die. My son died out there. And you didn't accept it. You see? And that'll be the end of it. But don't think that you're not going to know people outside that wall. Because you will. That's why we need to do everything we can for those people. Because if we don't, we'll be outside that wall. Is that where you want to be? We can't change one thing. We can't alter one thing. It must be as this pattern right here is. Our diet, our dress, our lifestyle, our actions, our very character. You don't need to know a word of what's in this Bible if you're controlled by the Holy Spirit, because it's all there. If you're sincere in seeking God, it's all there. Just as the animals know where their safety lies, so would we, as instinctive as those fish and birds know. It's there. There's our safety. No matter what happens, no matter what happens, if we're in the palm, engraved upon the palms of his hands, it doesn't matter. We have to stop looking at loss and death as something to be shunned. When I read the story of the apostles being beaten and they were rather praising God that they could be treated as their set, how alien is that to me? When they were thrown in stocks in prison and their backs raw, singing praises and songs to the God, and when the prison doors blew open, Paul said, "Don't hurt yourself. We're here." The man was ready to kill himself because he knew that when the keeper of the jail came and found the prisoners gone, he was dead. They would kill him for that. Paul said, "Oh no, we're here." And then Paul makes the statement, "I have learned to be content no matter what situation I find myself in." This is a man that was stoned, shipwrecked, bitten by poisonous snakes, beaten in public, almost torn to pieces by mobs, sitting in Roman dungeons, not once, and he made this statement. Why was he content is the question that comes to mind. Because he knew in whom he trusted. It didn't matter. He also made the statement, a very wealthy, influential, powerful man at one time, wasn't he? "I count it all dung, the things I've given up." He also said, "For a brief moment, I suffer a little bit." Didn't he? This man had everything to live for. He was going to be a very powerful, influential man above and beyond anything he had. Don't forget, he had letters from the Sanhedrin to go out and do whatever he wanted. Didn't he? Given power over life and death. Didn't he? If Paul accused you, Saul, you were in trouble. You are going to prison at best, and at worst be put to death. On his say-so alone. But he said, all that was garbage. And I suppose he could have also said with Christ, near the end of his life, that the prince of this world comes, but he has nothing in me. Because he counted this world all dung. Other than one thing, and what was that? What was the one thing Paul counted of any value here? A soul. That was the only thing. And with all his intellect and all his teaching, after he came down from Mars Hill and he matched wits with the best of their teachers and PhDs, blew them away, he was sad. Why? Why? Because none of them saw the gospel message on that level. He then made the statement, "I will only preach Christ and him crucified. No more of this philosophical garbage. No more of this intellectual ping pong. Christ and him crucified." And then when he made that choice, he stood before the most powerful man in the world and preached the gospel, and that was in Rome in front of Caesar, correct? How many people do you think were in that court from all the nations around the world that heard this message, that took it back with them? Do you think everybody rejected it? Uh-uh. That's not how God works. How much influence do you think came out of that? When he simply preached Christ and him crucified. I don't know why our church has gone away from that. I don't know why our church is running away from the third angel's message at light speed. When it is the only thing that we have that God has given us to save man. And we're at the point in time now, folks, where the only thing that's going to get people's attention is a real stiff slap in the face. And that would be the third angel's message. So we don't have time to pussyfoot around. Do you think we do? Do you think these people that are coming into the message now have the luxury we have had decades to make decisions, to figure out whether we're going to eat a veggie burger or a hamburger? No, they don't have that luxury. And you see, the closer we are to the Lord and the stronger example we can be to them will strengthen them greatly. That's why it's so important that we get our lives together. That's why it's so important that we see to it that that pattern is built exactly as it's laid out in the apostles and the prophets, as Paul says. Being the foundation, knowing the scripture. Forget all this other garbage. Oh, did you read this book? No, I don't have time. Did you read this book? Did you read what so-and-so said that Mrs. White said? How many times have you heard that one? Oh, here, read this book. It even has Mrs. White's quotes in it. Well, then why don't I just read what Mrs. White says? Because Mrs. White said, don't believe what others say I said. Read what I said. Did they misrepresent Christ's words even while he was alive? Did they not even try and convict him at trial by his own words? But they weren't the words he spoke, were they? The context was gone. They were twisted and turned. But one could say, well, Jesus did say that. He was going to destroy the temple. Is that what he meant? Did he care about that rock building? No. No, he did not. Anyhow, we're out of time, folks. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, again, we come before your mighty throne, Lord, and we know where your throne is, and we know who is in charge. Father, that our lives may be the pattern that is shown forth by your Son, that we not deviate one bit from it. Help us, Lord, to get this world out of us, Father, and to realize that we must put all in heaven, Father, and lay it at the foot of your throne for you to do as you see fit with. Be with us this Sabbath day. Help us, Father, all to get more serious about serving you, Father, and getting out of here, Lord. Please forgive our sins and help us to overcome. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.